In the 16th talk in the series organized by the Teachers Against the Climate Crisis. So we are a non-funded organization, and nor are we connected to any political party. And our general purpose is to deepen engagement with the climate crisis among teachers and students in particular. And these talks are part of that effort. So today's talk, Low Carbon Transport in India, has possibly at least three contexts. One is that the transport sector worldwide is one of the fastest growing sectors as a source of carbon dioxide and other greenhouse gases. 70% of greenhouse gases emanate from cities, and transport is probably the biggest source in India after electricity. The second context is in the last 25 years of mobility and transport policy, which basically private cars have been propped up with a range of effects, even on the geographical spread and layout of cities. And even where public transport has been supported, it is nowadays increasingly and overwhelmingly going to finance the spread of metros, not buses. The third context is the current one and a very obvious one, which is the COVID-19 pandemic, in which clearly more buses are needed so that working people can move from point A to point B for work or whatever else they need to do. So this meeting, in a sense, links with the ongoing campaign led by Summit and IDS for more buses. And I'm glad that we have both Nishant and Rajendra Ravi also in the audience. Welcome. And we in the teachers group support the key demands of this campaign, which includes free, safe, and reliable public transport. So today's presentation by Professor Geetham Tiwari on low carbon transport in India. So it will present travel patterns in Indian cities and developments in the urban transport sector during the past few years. It will focus on the implications for greenhouse gas emissions and other associated externalities of different transport options and the opportunities and challenges in addressing these concerns. To address the issue of low carbon transport in India, we wouldn't have a better person than Professor Geetham Tiwari, who is the Chair Professor of Transport Planning at the Department of Civil Engineering at IIT Delhi. She has over 100 publications in peer-reviewed journals and has co-edited 4 books on transport planning and safety. She is Editor-in-Chief of the International Journal of Injury Control and Safety Promotion for about a decade, and she's also on the board of the International Association for Traffic Safety Science. So before I hand it over to Professor Tiwari, I'll just briefly say the format is such that she'll speak for about 45 minutes, and after which we'll open it out for questions, comments, and discussion. You're welcome to type in your comment or question in the chat box. If you prefer to ask the question verbally, you could also do so. Thank you very much for joining in, and over to you, Professor Tiwari. Thank you.
Thank you. It's wonderful to be part of this really important group. And I would start sharing my screen now. Okay, so in this, I would say rather brief talk, I'm just going to focus on low carbon transport discussion and specially focused on public transport systems. Kind of highlight what are the opportunities and challenges which Indian cities are facing as far as these public transport systems are concerned. So I would also like to link this low carbon debate with SDG goals, because at least in transport sector, there are strong synergies. If we are trying to meet SDG goals, of course, one of the goals there is also to reduce greenhouse gases and harmful emissions. But overall, many other targets have synergies with greenhouse gas reduction goals also. And these specific 6 goals are related to, targets are related to transport. It is related to deaths from road traffic crashes. It is also about energy efficiency. It's about reliable, sustainable, resilient infrastructure, very much related to climate crisis. But if you look at 11.2, 11.6, these are definitely strongly related to public transport systems. And it is basically, the target is to provide access to safe, affordable, accessible, and sustainable transport systems by 2030. And the measure is basically how many people are within 0.5 kilometer of walking distance from high quality public transport. So all this gets very, very closely related to climate crisis. So let's just spend a couple of minutes on what is low carbon transport. I'm sure most of us are aware of it, but still, for the sake of completion, let's just revisit some of the numbers. So in 2012, already this graph is from article in Energy Policy published in 2011. And basically it compared greenhouse gas emissions in different transport modes, basically CO2 equivalent per passenger kilometer. There are no surprises here, as you can look at car run on gasoline or petrol has the highest per passenger kilometer. And of course, bus, if you look at it, bus is much less than that. Rail transit is also much less. Scooter, basically are motorized two-wheelers, four-stroke engines, is almost less than 50% as compared to one-third of actually of cars. And electric car is better than gasoline car. But if you see here itself, it is higher than rail transit. It is higher than, it is also slightly higher than two-wheeler. It is definitely higher than bus, whether it's diesel bus or hydrogen fuel cell bus or natural gas bus. So these are some important numbers we have to keep in mind. Then in assessment report IPCC 5, this information was published. And here, if you just look at the blue lines, blue line is for passenger transport. And here, now it is actually giving a range, because depending on what technology we are talking about, there is, if you look at cars, it is gasoline, diesel, hybrid, automobile. And you see the range is, the worst case scenario is maybe same as two and three wheeler motorcycles. And the best, in fact, the worst case scenario is much higher than that. But good case, you know, the more efficient technologies in cars that we are talking about, it compares with two-wheelers and three-wheelers. But as far as buses are concerned, the efficient systems are much better than any of these two, three-wheelers, or even very efficient cars, hybrid cars, etc. We do not have electric cars here. And then few numbers are also given for rail systems. So rail system is little less than, in fact, buses. But if you have not very efficient buses, then the rail system looks much better. So let's keep this in mind. And then we look at how we are going to look at and how we can estimate what are the total annual greenhouse gas emissions from transport sector. So there are four important aspects. The first, of course, the system structure, which is talking about modal choice. So if people end up choosing a mode which is more efficient, for example, pedestrians and bicycles are almost zero emission modes. And then now we have seen that buses and even rail transit is better than cars. So first is the percentage, the share of people who are choosing these different modes. Then we look at how, what is the fuel carbon intensity on which these modes are working. So this is basically diesel, gasoline, CNG, all different fuels are going to have different carbon intensity. And in the first case, of course, you know, how, why we choose certain mode has a lot to do with how we are designing our cities. Urban form has a lot, a very, very strong role to play in terms of influencing our decisions in which modes we are going to choose. If we have dense, mixed land use cities, more people end up using, you know, doing shorter trips and also walking and bicycling. Then next, we also look at energy intensity. So here we are looking at different types of vehicles. What is the efficiency of that itself? And what are the occupancy rate of different vehicles? And then in activity, we are looking at how many passenger kilometers. So the distances people are traveling is also having an influence on our total greenhouse gas emissions. And as you can see here, it is basically multiplication of that and summation of all different modes, summation of different fuels, fuel intensity, energy intensity, and activity or distances that we are traveling. So now with this quick background information, I want to share with you a short case study that we had done. And basically the case study was looking at environmental impacts of a compressed natural gas bus, which is running in Delhi, and we compared it with a metro system running in Delhi. And the unit of comparison was environmental impact of trip of 1 passenger kilometer done by bus versus done by metro rail. And important, you know, one departure that a different method that we used here was a life cycle assessment method. This has become very common now. If you go to any database search, you will find many papers published on this. Recently, in last 5 to 10 years, on transport systems also. It was originally for products, looking at what are the resource consumption and waste products from the production of what is the methodology is called from cradle to grave. So basically from producing the product to using it to disposing it off. This concept has been now used for transport services also. So we looked at, and this is especially important because there has been a lot of debate you must have seen in either in our media or ministry's websites that in the name of public transport, there has been a huge support for metro rail. It is being supported by Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs. Many cities have already completed some small systems. Delhi already has Delhi alone has nearly 400 kilometers. And in lot of another 15 cities, it is under construction. So the question we were asking, if a bus passenger shifts to metro, does it reduce harmful impact on environment? And this question we tried to answer by using life cycle assessment method for estimating adverse impact. So as I mentioned, life cycle assessment is looking at all four aspects, extracting and processing raw material, manufacturing, transportation, and distribution aspects, use, reuse, and maintenance, and then finally recycling and final disposal. So when we look at transport services, this is how it is organized. First, we look at resource and energy consumption at three levels: preparation, maintenance, and production and consumption. And at each these three stages, we also look at emissions into environment. So if you look at life cycle of road transport, we are looking at vehicle operation, vehicle fleet, and road infrastructure. And road infrastructure itself will consist of road infrastructure construction, operation and maintenance, and final disposal. And then the fleet, which is being used for these roadway systems, let us say bus. So manufacturing process, maintenance process, and disposal. And then during operation. Same thing we do for metro system also. So this is just to give you a quick flavor of how it is done. It's a very detailed method. It requires a lot of detailed inventory. So for example, if we start looking at Delhi Metro, we have to know what we had done was for phase 1, 2 and Airport Express. What is the total kilometer? How much of it is underground? How much is elevated and how much at grade? Why? Because construction method and construction technology changes, whether it's underground, elevated, or at grade. And then we have to have a lot of these specifications, what kind of material and what are the exact specification, because then we know what is the energy intensity of that. So based on this detailed method, when we start actually, now I'll start just showing you results, we start looking at what is the result we get from using this method. And as you can see here now, in this final table, I'm showing you for Delhi CNG bus and Delhi Metro. Unit of comparison is this CO2 equivalent passenger kilometer. And so it's telling you total what are the different emissions from here? We can focus on greenhouse gases. I think PM10 is also important for us from health point of view. But if we just look at greenhouse gases in operation, during operation, 6.82 CO2 grams of CO2 equivalent passenger kilometers coming from CNG bus, and compare that to metro, it is double. It is also telling us, the last column is telling us, what is the percentage of CO2 greenhouse gas emissions for this whole, let's say for bus. So 48% is coming at the time of operation, and for metro it is 52%. Now let's look at some other comparisons. So here it is looking at, you know, a lot of other impacts: carcinogens, respiratory organics, respiratory inorganics, climate change impacts, etc., etc. So if you just look at climate change impacts, red color is for road transport and green for rail transport. So again, you can see, compared to road transport, rail is almost double of that. And same thing actually is just showing you here the ratios. So carcinogen is eight times nearly higher for metro as compared to bus. Let's say climate change is 1.8, nearly two times higher. And then you can look at impacts on a lot of other aspects also. Human health, if we try to compare, again, you can see green is for metro. So human health impact metro is also much worse than bus. So the conclusion from this quick case study, we arrive at that there are significant energy and environmental impacts due to infrastructure construction. Whether it's metro or road, it doesn't matter. In both cases, it is happening. Vehicle manufacturing and maintenance. It's all aspects are important. And especially for greenhouse gases, it's really important because it doesn't matter where CO2 is produced, whether it is somewhere in the farm or in the city, it's going to impact our planet. So therefore, it's a global impact. So overall, we have to look at the emission. Location hardly matters. And that is why LCA methodology is important here. At least LCA should be adopted. And in the recent publications, you will find more and more people are actually recommending LCA methodology. Electricity used to, and I think some of you may have guessed also why metro is showing higher adverse impacts, because metro is running on electricity. And in India, our electricity is still very much coal-based. That is why this harmful impact is happening. If our electricity was clean, then we would see a different result. And because of this unclean electricity, metro is producing 7.5 times more carcinogens, 1.8 times more greenhouse gases as compared to CNG bus in Delhi. And of course, CNG is also creating many harmful things, including ozone depletion substances, which is 4.8 times more than metro. So now that we have understood metro, if we use LCA, because of the kind of electricity we use, has harmful impacts. But if you see in our current policies, as far as mobility is concerned, in last four, five years, we do have a national electric mobility mission now. And transport electrification has been promoted as one of the major programs by the government. And there are a lot of things, critical areas which have been identified, including demand incentives. The plan estimates that for EVs, the investment requirement would be something like 13,500 crores to 13,850 crores. Whereas for buses, the investment would be about only 500 to 550 crores. But there is huge push for transport electrification. And if you go to Ministry of Industry website, you will find there is a whole program which is called Faster Adoption and Manufacturing of Hybrid and Electric Vehicles, Phase 1 and 2. And under first FAME 1, a lot of incentives were offered to the cities. However, we were not very successful in really actually getting buses on the ground and on the road and running it. So there is phase two of FAME also. Now, again, many cities have trying to actually get buses and run these electric buses. Tenders have been floated, but most cities are planning only few buses under this scheme because obviously electric bus is going to be much more expensive than a normal bus. But we still have yet to see really some states are running buses on pilot basis, but a whole fleet has not happened yet. Okay, so let's look at how do people travel in Indian cities? Because oftentimes, I find even the media is so concerned about everybody using cars and cars are choking our cities. It's true. That is the picture we find in our on our roads. But for many of the things, we have to look at hard data. And so far, I can still go back to census only, because census 2011 for the first time published how people travel to work, both in rural and urban areas. And what you see on this slide is based on urban districts. And of course, you can see here that 49% people who travel to work do not use motorized transport at all. And the highest number is actually people are going to work walking, followed by motorized two-wheeler and buses, and then bicycles. And of course, there is a difference between how men and women are going to work. More women are using buses compared to men, and more men are using motorized two-wheeler as compared to women, and more men are using bicycles. What about distances? Are people traveling long distances? Actually, the census tells us no. Most people are not traveling very long distances. You can see percentage of workers who are traveling longer than 10 kilometers really very small. And almost 70% people going to work is less than 5 kilometers. So this is how people are traveling. Actually, these numbers should not be a surprise, because if you recall the first thing that we discussed, that how cities are designed has also a major impact on how people travel. It is also partly because of our poverty, because people don't have many choices. But traditionally, Indian cities have been dense and more mixed land use. And that is why we find that a majority of the people don't have to travel longer distances. So let me just take you through a very quick exercise on which is the preferred mode of travel. Because individually, I think all of us can relate to it. Anytime we try to make a decision to travel, of course, we consider many factors. Cost is important, comfort is important, safety is important. But travel time is one of the most important factors. We always try to save time in travel. So quick exercise for you. Suppose if you are doing only a 3 kilometer trip, if we walked, it would take about more than 25 minutes. Bicycle would take about 15 minutes. But if we had a very efficient bus system, a bus system which does not get stuck in congestion, and that is possible if we can reserve lanes for buses, even efficient bus system for 3 kilometer trip will take longer than bicycle. And then if we have a very, very efficient metro system also, an extensive metro system, so it could be the metro stop and the bus stop could be at the same place, there you find that a metro system is going to take little longer than a bus system. Now, if we have access to car or motorized two-wheeler, a personal mode, it will be shorter than any of these modes. But only thing is, not always. If the roads are congested, then the car even for 3 kilometer trip would be longer than bicycle. So for public transport, and we know that walking, bicycle and buses and metros are what we can call carbon friendly modes, less carbon intensive modes. That's what we saw in first few slides. But for public transport systems, you have to remember access and egress plays a very important role. You cannot use any public transport without walking to it or using any other mode to access it. And that is where the difference between metro and bus comes. And then, of course, we have to improve the in-vehicle time, since metro is completely exclusive right of way. So the time is very reliable and predictable. If we are able to do that for buses also, we can get the same benefit from bus systems also. For 12 kilometer trip, if you see, so now metro starts looking a little better than bus system, because we are spending more time, longer distance inside the vehicle. So this is one aspect that we have to remember, that depending on the distance we are traveling, different modes become more attractive to us. If you look at distribution of work trips, and I'm using again numbers from census, it tells us that actually walk and bus, again in Delhi, are the proportion of people using this for work is highest as compared to any other mode. So of course, census was done in 2011. So where at that time, we did not have an extensive metro system that we have today. So however, this train is including metro trips, which is very small in 2011. Even if we double it, it would become 5 or 6% only. And the bus numbers would still be much higher as compared to metro. So this is something we have to keep in mind. And then we had done a study looking at many cities, a kind of a scenario analysis, what is the expected trips on metro in these cities. So if you see quickly, it is actually showing most of the cities will be in the range of 4 to 5%. In big cities like Delhi and Mumbai, it can go up to 10 to 15%, provided we have a really, really extensive network, like all arterial roads end up having metro lane lines, then we would hit this target. And this is happening because the way our cities are organized and the distances people have to travel. So metro is very attractive for long trips. We have also seen that it is kind of low carbon as compared to personal modes of transport, but it's going to benefit people who are traveling more than 8 to 10 kilometers. And we've seen that usually from census, at least we know that cities which are with more than 3 million population, the share is less than 10%. Due to high capital requirement of metro projects, government support is required in the form of equities and grants and various tax exemptions. That is how Delhi Metro and many other metros in the country are operating. A major part of revenue of metro system comes from sources other than fare box revenue. So that means the self-sustainability becomes a question. See, the subsidy is required in all public transport systems. It doesn't matter whether it's metro or bus. But in metro, it would be higher than bus, because metro itself, the capital expenditure itself is very much, much higher than bus system. So this is a glance of how, you know, in Delhi Metro now, the increasing dependence is on external projects and not on what we are getting from fare box. And in fact, in 17, actually, Delhi Metro had to increase their fare suddenly. That happened because they were required, you know, now Delhi Metro's moratorium for low interest loan is over. So they have to pay interest on the loan also. So that is why. And once the fares were increased, then of course your ridership went down. But over the years, I mean, this is only example for Delhi Metro, because we still don't have such extensive system in any other city. So over the years, the number of buses in the city have been going down. And number, you know, kilometers and rolling stock of metro has been steadily increasing. And this is this actually matches with the ridership also. As the number of buses go down, of course, then the number of people using bus systems also goes down. And as kilometers of metro increases, we have increasing number of people using metro. So after having understood, you know, that different trip lengths, different systems are more attractive. So we look at, we've seen that a bus system can become quite attractive between 5 to 15 kilometers. Open bus or BRT is also resembles, I mean, also is very beneficial for these length of trips. Metro or closed BRT, which is very, it resembles metro system on road. That is very attractive for trips when people are traveling longer than 15 kilometers. And we've seen that bicycle is very, quite suitable for trips up to 5 kilometers. We've also seen that, you know, already in India, a lot of people are using bicycle and walking. But I think the important thing is that these people are captive users. Today, we have a lot of people walking and bicycling and in fact using buses also, not because this is their first choice, but because they do not have any other choice. So I think the for us, when we talk about low carbon mobility options for future also, our challenge is to retain these trips and only then we look at if carbon intensive modes can shift to these less carbon intensive modes, and then we can improve the efficiency of carbon intensive modes. So basically, if we look at our situation, Indian situation, two strategies become very important here. Improve public transport systems, and we have to improve infrastructure for non-motorized transport, which is bicycle and pedestrians, because then only we can retain and we can make choice users come to these modes of transport. So a quick results, I want to share a result from another case study, scenario building we did for a couple of cities in India. And we created three scenarios. We improve NMT infrastructure. Second was improve bus infrastructure. And third was improve, actually combine one and two. And then we were kind of looking at a range of what kind of modal shifts are possible. So we created, you can say, a maximum shift scenario or optimistic scenario versus a more pessimistic or low shift scenario. So these are the numbers we had used. And here the results are for Delhi, Pune and Patna. So only thing, important thing to understand here is, so this is showing you actually fuel consumption. What is the impact of doing under these three scenarios on fuel consumption? So for Delhi, we have gasoline, CNG, and you can see in scenario one, where we are only doing public non-motorized transport infrastructure. There is a small difference, but when we do second scenario, improving public transport, so in this scenario, since we are going to increase number of buses, so CNG increases. And in other cities, depending on what is the mix of diesel and CNG, your numbers differ. And fuel consumption is directly related to CO2 emissions also. So those are the impacts you see here also. So we can actually, the range is quite high because this is because of maximum shift and least shift scenario. And in scenario two with three, which is a combination of non-motorized and public transport improvement, we get the highest benefit in all three cities. Also, we did for very small cities, you know, cities of the size of Patiala and Bulandshahr. These are the cities we don't see many studies being done in these city sizes, and there are more than 300 cities of this size in India. So here also you see the three scenarios. If we do improve NMT itself, you know, this is only modal shifts, but you know that modal shifts is directly related to carbon emissions and fuel efficiency, fuel consumption. So we are actually able to shift people from motorized two-wheelers. We don't look at cars because the number of car users in these cities, including Delhi also, you've seen is very small. So if you look at only motorized two-wheeler also, the shift is, you know, all the reds are showing that the trips are shifting to carbon-friendly modes, shifting towards NMT and also towards public transport. IPT, the three-wheeler systems that are operating in these cities, not much change there. So this was for Patiala, and similar things, you know, you can see same, very similar results in Bulandshahr also. So let's, in last 5 minutes, let's just go understand this, you know. We've seen that buses are playing an important role. They will continue to play an important role in future also for many reasons. But there is a difference between need for buses versus demand for buses. There is a need because we have old and young people who cannot drive, low ownership of cars. Of course, buses are going to face challenge from two-wheeler ownerships. There is increasing dependence on non-agricultural activities in rural areas also. Also, access to education, health facilities, and that's why buses are required there also. In large urban areas, there is spatial expansion, but again, we've seen that majority of our trips are not longer than 10, 15 kilometers. So bus will continue to play a very important role. And in small urban areas also, it's very important because people are commuting to nearby town for work. But what has happened? The demand for bus, that means who's going to pay for bus? Who's going to buy buses? This comes from the state government or city governments. Individuals are not going to buy buses. So that is where the big, I think, challenge comes. Because we had formal systems, mostly state-run systems, which were introduced in 50s, but by 1980s, many states had started withdrawing state support because of financial losses. And today also you see the discussion is always around buses about financial losses. And in the new motor vehicles bill also, there is big incentive for privatization of buses. And also we find that from 2000 onwards, when metro system starts getting introduced, there is a competition for state funds. Most state funds are going to now metro systems in many states, along with the support from the center and external borrowings. But what is happening to buses? It's completely missing. Not only that, I think that bus systems are being treated as a revenue generation sources for states. And as a result of it, we have number of buses per lakh population has declined. Trips on buses have declined. And to my mind, even a more serious issue is that manufacturers have no interest in bringing upgrading technology, and very little indigenous technology innovation has happened. So because manufacturers see there is no demand or market for it, because governments have not created, governments, center or state governments have not created that market. 2006 to 2014, we did have slightly different scenario. You see in 2006, only 26 states were operating formal bus systems in 20 cities. But 2014, 31 states had started operating some form of bus system or the other in almost 177 cities. And this happened because in 2008, during, you know, when there was major economic depression, the government came out with a package to help automobile industry by offering actually grants for introducing bus systems. So this had a major impact. But what is the current scenario? The current Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs, and I've given a quote here, road infrastructure, including parking, has the largest share of current allocation, 32%, followed by transit infrastructure, which is your metro systems, gets 29%. Active transport, so some cities are talking about walking and cycling, it's getting about 14%. But where is bus? It's completely missing from this. Future needs, urban population is going to double in next 20 years. Most urban areas will be mixed use, so there will be need for buses. Access to private vehicles, cars will remain low in India, and we will continue to have captive users, women and low-income households. And we've seen that metro alone cannot meet the need of public transport for all. But just have a quick look at this, how buses are being treated. In Delhi, I mean, this is only one, GST, which was not there earlier. Now for metro, 12% is required, for buses 28% GST has been imposed. And even a taxi has less than bus. But every ticket that people buy, metro has zero GST on it. And buses, on bus operations, a vehicle is owned by a public authority, is 18%. So we really have to see how we are treating buses. So finally, we come to this. So we have seen that Sustainable Development Goal 11.2 requires meeting, creating quality systems within accessible distance, and that we can only meet if we create good bus systems. And so for that, the requirement is bus systems should be declared as essential services. It cannot be run as a profit-making business. It has to be given priority on roads, operations, and financing. And unless states prepare a long-term plan, we will not see manufacturers improving technology. Perhaps we need new institutional mechanisms to run small buses in small towns. And we have come up with all kinds of interesting financial packaging for metro systems. Why don't we have an integrated packaging, both which looks at metro and bus together? And Centre has an act for metro act. I think it should be replaced with a public transport act where buses and metros are seen as an integrated system. And final challenges would be from two-wheeler, because our two-wheeler ownership is very high. And, you know, in this current situation that we have seen since March, pandemic, even though the history of pandemic shows us that these impacts don't last very long, not certainly beyond 2 years, but even since people have this fear of crowd, the requirement is to have more buses on the road, not actually stop buses. And I think the other major challenge comes from decision makers, planners, and car users, because these three groups certainly are not willing to prioritize right of way, basically give space to buses on the road, exclusive right of way. And unless that happens, we really can't meet all the challenges. So I can stop here. I think it's about maybe 5 minutes over, about 50 minutes.
Oh, thank you. You're absolutely exactly in time. It's perfect. And thank you for a rich and very wide-ranging sort of discussion on varied aspects of low carbon mobility in Delhi and many cities. So like we had said earlier, we'd now open it out for, there already are a number of questions and observations in the chat box. So would you like to read them yourself, or should I just read them out to you and you can then respond? We got an order.
I will stop sharing my screen.
Yeah, please. Thank you. So again, I request everybody to type in their questions or comments in the chat box. If anybody wishes to speak up and ask it themselves from Professor Tiwari, please do so. Yeah, in some order. Yeah. So I think I'll just go to the beginning, Geetam, to the questions right at the top. In case I miss any, just let me know. So there's a question from Ojit, and his question, would you, Dr. Tiwari, would you also factor road accidents, a major killer in your arithmetic, while comparing the merits of metro versus bus? Right at the top.
Factor road accidents, a major killer in your arithmetic, while looking at the merits of metro versus buses. Yes, absolutely. However, both for metro and bus, what is interesting is that, yes, metro itself is not killing people on the road. But, you know, we find that how do you approach a metro system? You walk to a metro system, or you're using two-wheeler, or you're using another bus. And that is when you get higher exposure and risk. So, and for buses also, actually, we find that once you are inside the bus, the chances of getting involved in crash is very small. But while you're approaching a bus stop, that is when you're exposed to highest risk. So Metro has a major advantage in that it has an exclusive right of way. It is not getting mixed with other traffic. So therefore, it is not imposing that kind of risk to other road users. But as a Metro user, while during access and egress trip, you have high risk, just as bus users. That is the difference between the two systems.
So he actually, Ajit actually had a couple of questions about that, which I missed, which were sort of comparing sources of energy. Ajit, your wording is not entirely clear. You are talking about biofuels and about nuclear energy and why nuclear is being promoted so rigorously. It's slightly a distance from what Professor Tiwari presented, but still, would you like to come in and ask the question? Because your wording is not clear to me, at least. Ajit?
Yes. Oh, hello, am I audible to?
Yes.
My question is, I think few years ago, there was a lot of hue and cry and people are talking about the biofuels, hybrid. That's what I perceive from the readings, especially Yojana, Kurukshetra, very general and science reporter. People are talking about biofuels, hybrid. But nowadays, I think we are more talking about the clean energy. We're talking more about the radioactive energy. We're talking more about electricity, which is mainly derived from the nuclear fuels. At least that's what I'm observing. People have done away with, so we have a lot of this discussion on coal has to be replaced by radioactive energy. And the present government, I think, is doing a lot of rigorous work to establish nuclear reactors and so on and so forth. So my question is, if the organic fuels or the biofuels comes into picture, it will surely help in generating a kind of transport mechanism, which is depending on, suppose, for example, it can be used by the small vehicles. But when we talk about electricity, radioactivity, this is going to fuel the mass transport system to a great extent. I absolutely don't know where to put, but my whole idea is, why not we work towards the achievement of the biofuels? And
actually,
and you also mentioned about traditional, the more traditional knowledges.
Government, I mean, there's some discussion that I've seen at TIFAC and DST. There is a lot of push from the government, from Niti Aayog also, to look into biofuels. But, you know, most of the biofuels have really not have not been very successful as a commercial use yet in India. So they have talked about mixing of ethanol, methanol, and a lot of other things also, but it's not at a large scale. That's one. Second, you said electricity. Actually, you know, electricity is also important. You must have seen e-rickshaws coming up everywhere. And these are basically that using lead acid battery. But it is being charged from the same electricity. So electricity is not only for mass transport. I mean, not just for metro. It is also all these e-vehicles. The charging is from these unless one goes for solar, etc., again, that does not have a mass use right now. So that is why, you know, this is a more traditional comparison, because mostly the majority, when you see the mass use, this is what is happening. Other things are still on experimental stage.
Exactly, that's what I'm, even in the university area that I'm in, most of the e-rickshaws are connecting to the metro station to some pockets where the students are there. But so overall, it's all about electricity and electricity and also the source of electricity, which is mainly fueled by radioactivity, mainly fueled by So at the end, the carbon footprint is equally very, very large, and it's enlarging.
Absolutely, yeah. Unless clean or electricity, it's going to have large carbon footprint.
So Rohit has a question about the comparison that you've made. He's asking from the comparison he made between the metro and car and bike users and not just buses. What if car and bike to the metro?
We were looking at actually public transport. You know, of course, this comparison can be done. But this comparison would be, I mean, the answer you already know, because from the first slide only, we know that car and motorized two-wheelers per passenger kilometer are much more carbon intensive than metro. So this answer we already know. Of course, to quantify, we can still come up with that number. But already from the first slide, you know that cars and bikes, even four-stroke engines, can only be sometimes as good as metro per passenger kilometer. So that's why only bus and metro comparison is interesting. But if one wants to get a quantified, yes, this is possible. We can do it.
Could I request all to keep your mics on mute, please? Yeah, please carry on. Sorry.
Can I just add?
Yeah, Rohit, please. Yeah, carry on.
Yeah, so my question was in the context of, you know, I mean, if we were to look at the role that metro is playing, so people, if they're moving away from cars and it's not merely a substitution, I understand the public transport bit that between the two buses are more efficient. But we are also discussing the possibility of people moving away from private vehicles to public transport because there is metro. Had it been only a bus, then people are not making those choices, whatever may be the reason for it, timing, so on and so forth. But if they are making the transition from private transport to public because of metro, then this comparison should include that, right? I mean, it gives the impression as if metro and bus we are comparing irrespective of, it's like, you know, economics we say ceteris paribus, everything else remaining the same. But everything actually is not remaining the same when metro is, I mean, I'm sure Delhi Metro has made a difference in terms of...
Do you remember I showed you a slide on how people travel in Delhi? What was the
percentage
of trips by metro in that?
No, Professor Tiwari, don't get me wrong.
So that's what I'm saying. What you are saying is correct. However, the number of car users is so small.
It's so small, yes. Yeah. No,
the number of metro users are so small. So two things happen with metro. One, it in fact induces long trips. So in case of Delhi Metro, when two phases were done, we had estimated that 16% of the trips were induced trips. People would not make that trip if the system was not there. Second is that majority of the shift had occurred from two-wheelers and buses. And buses, because many bus routes had been stopped. So overall, it's absolutely true what you're saying, that if people shift from car to metro, it is a benefit. It is definitely a benefit. And motorized two-wheeler people also shift to metro. They get huge safety benefit also, along with carbon benefits. But if you remember that overall, if you are not doing long trip, your choice would still not, first choice will not be metro. So by metro, we have enabled people to comfortably travel from Gurgaon, from Faridabad. I'm talking just a case of Delhi, but this would be true in any other city also, long trips. So my actually understanding is that unless you integrate the two systems, we are not solving the problem.
Oh, absolutely. You're totally in agreement.
Integration is not happening and a lot of investment is gone only for metro.
Absolutely. Yeah.
That is where the problem
is. So next question actually relates to how the metro runs. So both Rohit and I had sort of similar questions. I was wondering when your data for the Delhi Metro was from, which year? I was told recently that the Delhi Metro was by now quite heavily reliant on solar, 90% of the current electricity used. And I think Rohit has a similar question about, does it run more on renewable energy sources? We're talking about the Delhi Metro specifically, not the other metros. I believe it comes from a solar plant in Madhya Pradesh, Rewa or some such thing. Is that right?
Sorry, I didn't. So what was the question? Because I saw
The question was just about the specifics about the source of electricity for the Delhi Metro.
Right. Yeah.
We'd heard recently is about a few weeks or months ago, that the Delhi Metro was sourcing its electricity from a solar plant in Madhya Pradesh, but about 90% of its electricity is from solar. Is that accurate?
I can look up, but most of the electricity is this conventional electricity, which they get at a very cheap rate. They have heavy subsidies on that also.
I see. All right. So you're saying it's not possibly not solar to that degree.
Yeah.
Okay. So next question is again a different source of energy from Praveen. He asks, CNG is predominantly methane. Isn't that also a sort of carcinogenic source?
Yeah. Of course, CNG has other problems because it burns at a higher temperature. So there is NOx also. But GHG emissions are lower as compared to coal-based electricity.
So Praveer has a question lower down below, which I'm sure many people tend to, about the odd-even system. So he asks, do you think the odd-even system has any effect on pollution? I'm just skipping a few just to mix up the questions.
Yeah. No, odd-even...
Make an effect on pollution, or is it just a political sort of gimmick or a political necessity?
No, I think it is not going... we have done it 3 times now in Delhi. It has not had any major, even I would say medium-term impacts. And I'm saying that because actually for all three, we are just finishing that work also. One of my student is working on this, that she's comparing all 3 times what is the impact in terms of people changing their behavior, in terms of higher occupancy of vehicles, more people using shared vehicles or changing routes or changing using any other mode. We don't see any major change happening in that direction.
Ethan, is that because it was too short? My memory was it was at least 2 of the times, it was not more than 2 weeks.
You know, actually, odd even has been tried out in so many different cities. So both things happen. Actually, for short durations, is what we see some impact, but when you actually implement it for longer duration, then people start coming up with a second vehicle that they can use, or so actually the impact starts wearing off completely.
But won't the proportion of the rich who have 2 vehicles be sort of quite low? For instance, how many?
No, so people end up buying any other poor quality second vehicle. That has been the experience in Mexico City and some other cities. So the bottom line is, unless we provide good options for people, that is why the importance of investing in quality public transport and bicycle lane is absolutely important. And in fact, the more space you make for cars, there are so many studies showing that the more comfortable you make for cars, more people are going to use it. So if we keep targeting that, there's too much congestion and we need to solve that problem for cars, that means in a way you are encouraging more people to use cars. So I think very clear policy shift is required, that let us start focusing on providing quality public transport. And that's where I say, let's integrate metro and buses together. And then have walking and bicycling, because both are providing you last mile connectivity in feeder modes. So if we keep focusing on, there is no space, we have narrow roads, we have too many cars, I find that's a non-starter.
Yeah, so I'm in agreement. And going on to that, I had a sort of broad, slightly wishful question, not entirely from left field. As in, there used to be sort of a limit on, let's say, for instance, gas cylinders that any household could own up until not very long ago, and other such resources, there are limits. Can we think about, like, say, if we think about a limit on the number of cars that a household could use, and particularly given the growing gravity of both the climate and the pollution crisis, should we be thinking or demanding a limit on the number of cars that a household owns and a limit on the number of cars that any city of any given size can introduce on the roads each year? Or is that just too wishful thinking?
Yeah, you know, but the problem in these strategies is that if you look at our numbers, the per capita ownership of car is very low in India. But I agree that, in fact, you know, it's not just car ownership. We are providing all kinds of subsidies to cars. They have free parking. The road is being done by government. And parking at home, parking at your destination. People park at road for no cost. So there are heavy subsidies for car use, direct and indirect. But on the other hand, in fact, you know, even the way we have formed the bylaws, that we require people to provide parking at home and also parking in the office. And one very interesting empirical evidence comes from a lot of studies is that use of car, actually the location of parking determines whether you're going to use car or public transport. Your public transport, you have to walk at least, let's say 50 meters, 100 meters. And your car and your two-wheeler is at your doorstep. So the moment you step out and you find your car, your decision is done. So a lot of cities are now, you know, making it more and more difficult parking. And that seems to have some impact on use and choice of using car. So you can own a car, but you cannot use it every day, and you can use it for other purposes when the roads are more not so congested. But limiting car at this low car ownership becomes a little difficult to sell. You know, our car ownership in India is very low right now. We have motorization because of motorized two-wheelers. That has high ownership.
So Shovik Chakravarti has a couple of questions. One is a clarificatory question. He says, while comparing the emissions between buses and metros, are the comparisons made with air-conditioned buses or with non-AC buses?
And this was for non-AC bus. We used a green bus specifications.
Okay.
Non-AC, yeah. Yes, for AC bus, the fuel consumption is higher, so it would be different.
Right. Yes. But not very much higher? I mean, how much would it be, like in terms of GHG?
I really haven't seen it. Yeah, it would be slightly higher because only at the time of operations it will make some difference.
Yeah. I think Shovik Neep wants to come in. There is a second question as well. Shovik, come in, yeah.
Yes.
Hi, Professor Tiwari. Thank you very much. It was an excellent talk, and I learned a lot from your presentation, and I have been following your work very closely. So the reason why I asked this question is because metro in Delhi is climate controlled. Like they have air conditioning. So I was just imagining that given that the emissions from the air conditioned buses might be quite high, and because it's climate control, this one is climate control. So will it be a fair comparison in that sense?
It would make a slight difference, as I said, that because the AC buses would use more fuel, everything else will remain the same. So fuel consumption would be slightly higher than non-AC bus. So that is where it may become higher. But some of the things where we saw the ratios, you know, 7 times more, 2 times more, that gap may reduce a little bit, but it would still be a little higher.
All right. And I completely, like, from the political perspective, I completely agree with you about this thing that it both the systems need to be complemented with each other, the buses and the metro. Otherwise, the system fails in many ways. And following that, this was something which has coming to my mind for a long time, that in the advanced countries, we now see there is a lot of movement about this bicycle lanes, dedicated bicycle lanes in the urban cities. So in India, the working class mainly depends on bicycle as a some means of transportation. For why doesn't we find that any such movement happening in India, like in Delhi or Calcutta or any other major cities for dedicated bicycle lanes? We hear like Delhi had this bus lane, although they later retracted, but we really don't find anything like a dedicated bicycle lanes for the people to.
Yeah, actually for dedicated bicycle lanes and for buses is the same challenge that I mentioned towards the end. That, I mean, for Delhi bus lanes also, it was the same thing. Every survey showed that bus users were extremely happy and even the bus drivers were very happy driving in that exclusive lane. But it was the majority car users who became unhappy. And along with that, the media and the decision makers. So the whole, it became, you know, that you want to make a bus lane so that car users are happy. If that's the objective, then you can't meet this objective.
All right.
To answer your question, why it doesn't happen, because I think our minority, in fact, in this case, I will say not even minority, majority people do not have voices. It's completely dominated by car users and media and the decision makers. And maybe the whole politics behind it, I would request Rajendra Ravi ji is also in this forum right now. He would be the right person to give you really good understanding of what the politics behind bicycling is. Because he's been working in many other cities to...
सभी को नमस्ते. आवाज आ रही है? देखिए, दरअसल में जो डेवलपमेंट का जो एक इमेज क्रिएट किया गया है उसमें कार एक डेवलपमेंट का प्रतीक बना दिया गया है और साइकिल को एक पिछड़ेपन का प्रतीक बनाया गया है. तो अगर नंबर देखेंगे कि ज़्यादा भी है साइकिलिस्टों का तो भी वो बोलते नहीं हैं. और एक ऐसा इमेज क्रिएट किया गया है कि जो सड़कें हैं वो कारों के लिए है और सबके लिए नहीं है. इसलिए जो साइकिल यूजर हैं वह भी एक किस्म से इस दबाव में रहते हैं कि हमें अर्न करके कमाई करके मोटराइज मोड ऑफ ट्रांसपोर्ट पे शिफ्ट होना है. और इसमें मीडिया, इंटेलेक्चुअल जो कम्युनिटी है, इन सब का बहुत बड़ा रोल है. आप देखेंगे कि अभी लॉकडाउन के दौरान बहुत सारे साइकिल नए किस्म के आए हैं या फिर जो शौक से साइकिल चलाते हैं वो उसी साइकिल को उसी रोड को यूज करते हैं जिसको कि कार मालिक यूज करते हैं. लेकिन उसके प्रति व्यवहार और जो नॉर्मल साइकिल यूजर है उसके प्रति व्यवहार में अंतर होता है. क्योंकि कार यूजर को मालूम होता है कि यह जो साइकिलिस्ट है जो फैंसी साइकिल चला के जा रहा है यह हमारे ही वर्ग का प्रतिनिधित्व करता है. इसलिए ये लॉन्ग डिबेट है लेकिन इसके लिए जरूरी है कि राइट वेस अप्रोच बनाया जाए और जो सड़क का जिसका निर्माण है या इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर जो बन रहे हैं वो गरीब से गरीब आदमी के पैसे से भी उसमें लगता है. तो जैसे मजदूर अपने हकों के लिए इकट्ठा होते हैं और डिमांड करते हैं वेजेज के लिए, बेटर फैसिलिटी के लिए, उसी तरह से जहाँ जहाँ दुनिया में परिवर्तन हुए हैं, नीदरलैंड में या नॉर्वे में, वो हिस्ट्री अगर देखेंगे तो वहाँ साइकिलिस्टों ने मिलकर के यूनियन बनाई और पूरे यूरोप में साइकिलिस्ट यूनियन है जो बेटर साइकिल फैसिलिटी की डिमांड करते हैं। और इसके लिए जरूरी है कि जो कन्वर्टेड लोग हैं, जो डी क्लास लोग हैं, वो इसमें आगे आए। हमारे के यहाँ संकट ये है कि हम साइकिल की बात करते हैं लेकिन हम साइकिल पे चलते नहीं हैं, और जब चलते नहीं हैं तो उसके लड़ते नहीं हैं। तो आइडिया ऑफ साइकिलिंग जो है वो अलग होता है फिलोसफिकल, और फाइट फॉर साइकिल जो है वो अलग होता है। तो इसमें गैप बिटवीन आइडिया एंड रियल सिचुएशन, इसको देखना पड़ेगा। और ख़ास करके हम लोग का जो एक्सपीरियंसेज है कि जो कम्युनिटी पॉलिटिक्स को चेंज करने में आगे होता है डी क्लास होकर के, उसमें स्कूल, कॉलेज, टीचर्स, स्टूडेंट, इन सब का बहुत बड़ा रोल है और उनको आगे आना चाहिए। आप लोग उसी वर्ग में से आते हैं, अगर आप लोग कुछ आगे कदम बढ़ाएंगे तो शायद अभी नहीं तो कुछ सालों के बाद चेंज होगा। धन्यवाद।
बहुत शुक्रिया राजेंद्र जी, सच में बहुत ही बढ़िया इंटरवेंशन था आपका। जैसे आर एनी फर्दर क्वेश्चंस फॉर गीतम, आई जस्ट हैड वन इन केस देयर आरंट एनीबॉडी एल्स। एनीबॉडी एल्स वांट टू कम इन? इफ नॉट, आई हैड जस्ट अ ब्रॉड क्वेश्चन फॉर यू गीतम रिगार्डिंग पोस्ट लॉकडाउन सिनेरियोस इन डिफरेंट कंट्रीज इन यूरोप or in China or elsewhere in India. So what do you see as the main trajectories that transport is taking post-COVID and post-lockdown? I mean, there was a concern that people who could afford it would buy many more cars, whereas in Europe, you're seeing sort of different state responses. So what are the main kind of responses and trajectories that you are seeing in key?
Yeah, actually, so far, we don't see any surge in car buying. Also because what happened in most of the countries, in fact, I find probably India and maybe a few cities in China the only places where public transport was stopped during this. In none of the countries actually public transport ever stopped. There were advisories that, you know, you have to wear your mask and you cannot do crowding. And in Europe, actually number of buses were increased. So most places public transport continued and people who have to travel, they traveled. So yes, the transport, public transport use went down, but that also because people were not traveling as much as they were traveling earlier. Not that they started suddenly traveling more by cars. So as I said, you know, I have looked at some data from earlier pandemics. And the impact of reduced trip not more than 1 or 2 years. And then it comes back to normal. So to my mind, if we use this opportunity to really improve our public transport and low carbon mode like bicycling and walking, I mean, we can use this opportunity because, you know, roads are not as crowded now. Slowly, of course, they are coming back to normal traffic, but we could easily experiment with some reserve lanes for buses and bicycles. But you know, unfortunately, I mean, if I just give you a small example from our IIT campus itself, we have done the reverse. All these spaces that we had pedestrianized because of high volume of students, because now students are not there in person. So we have given back that space for car parking. So that is doing the reverse of what should be done.
Mayank, before you come in, Geetam, can I request you, if you don't mind, would you put your video back on?
Yeah, sure.
Just one minute. I'll turn mine off, you turn yours on. Yeah.
Yes.
So Mayank, 1 second, Mani ka ek prashn hai. So
Geetam,
elaborate about you talked about integrating the bus and metro systems. I think Mani is asking to elaborate about how that could be done. I understood
how? Okay.
Yes. It's right at the end. So, he says, what are the ways in which we can integrate these two systems, buses and...
Yeah. So actually, integration can happen, should happen at three levels. It has to happen at planning level, where the two systems, you know, so as I mentioned, you know, there are short trips, medium-sized trips, and long trips. So when you start planning a network, you know, short trips, many smaller roads, you have to have buses. And that overlay that on top of metro system, metro lines, which is mostly on your main arterial roads serving to long trips. At infrastructure level, the bus stop and metro stops very often. So sometimes you get down from a metro and you get a bus or vice versa. And third is that is infrastructure level, and third is operational level. And at planning level, actually, what another aspect I talked about was financial. So when you are actually putting together a financial package for metro, so we can construct 100 kilometers of metro, but along with that, we can also construct 20 kilometers of bus lanes, which is going to cost you, you know, a fraction of the money that you're going to invest in 100 kilometers of metro. Third important thing is, at operational level, you know, you have to integrate the ticket systems. Same ticket, you buy a pass or a ticket, should work at both, in both systems. And then how the revenue sharing is done between metro and bus systems, that has to be figured out. So unless we do all these three different levels of integration, basically it's not going to be. Not just that you make feeder buses go to a metro station. No, that is not integration at all. That's a very, very poor understanding of integration. Actually, if you know, you retained all your bus and on top of that overlaid a metro system, that would be a fantastic integrated system, because people can just, you know, get down from a bus and take a metro to go for a long trip. You don't need any extra feeder buses. So integration at operation.
So is there any city in India where this kind of integration has been done at least partially? Maybe Bombay? Is Bombay a little better than other places?
No, nowhere. You've seen now everywhere metro is being operated completely independently. In Bombay, you have a strong commuter rail, but that's separate from metro.
Bombay, the metro, anyhow, is only one line. It sort of goes.
Yeah, so your even simple thing. I mean, Kochi is trying with this integrated card.
Yes.
But Kochi is such a small city, and let's see how. I don't know. In Delhi, you've seen the debate. It's been talked about for such a long time, but we still haven't seen any integration here.
Correct.
Even we don't have a card which works on both systems yet.
There's for now one question from Pradeep. He's saying, is there any data available on the impact made by the last mile connectivity options like rent a bike, rent a bicycle, or a small EV on public road usage? That question is right down at the bottom.
You know, remember, yes, these are all good options, but our understanding is the reason we are not using, we don't have choice users for bicycles, because the roads are too hostile for bicycles. Many people may own bicycle. You could use your own bicycle to just go to metro station. But if the roads are not safe, then people avoid using it. So we can have all these rent a bicycle or public bicycle schemes, which initially metro also introduced. You could rent a bicycle for a small amount, or you could by downloading an app. But the question is the infrastructure safe to use bicycles? I think to me, that is a more important requirement. If we are able to do that, many people would start using bicycles for last mile connectivity.
Right. I think we have come to the end of a very fascinating discussion. Just to give just a couple of minutes, we don't mind Geetham. I'd like to bring in Nishant, if Nishant is present. Nishant, would you like to sort of briefly mention the key demands or the key points of the ongoing campaign? So Nishant is part of an ongoing campaign for more buses in Delhi as part of some ideas has been carrying out regular meetings and online campaigns and so on. So Nishant, would you like to come in briefly before we close today's?
Thanks, Mehta. It is kind of, I was just thinking that it would be quite relevant if I could just take a few minutes to talk about the campaign, because Professor Tiwari has kind of very succinctly, shown why the buses are the, need of the hour. And just to elaborate on that part, that, when we talk about buses, we talk about the needs, which are collective needs, and the needs which have to be sort of collectively provided for. It's not an individual need, neither it can be individually provided. So somewhere the responsibility of the state, the government, and the governance structure that we have comes in. And that's why we have this demand that not just we need buses, but in a sense, we need to reclaim the buses. We need to ask what kind of buses we need. And we actually need to ensure that the kind of buses which can facilitate a sort of a good mobility, universal mobility for everyone, are put in place along with the infrastructure, along with the systemic needs that are important to run it. So the demand of this campaign is to have a free, safe, and reliable bus-based public transport, where free component is about it asserts this idea that public buses are a right of citizens, and you don't need to have to be able to pay for this kind of mobility system. It should be such that everyone can use it at any time, at any place when they feel the need for it. Similarly, it's implicit that public transport of the kind that we were talking about, which has kind of exclusive lane or something of that sort, it's almost 100% safe. But it, when we talk about it from the gendered point of view, from a disability point of view, it's not safe currently. So we need a safe public transport so that more people can use it. And also the reliability part, because as we're talking that what perhaps makes metro more appealing is that this reliability component, that if you enter the metro system, you will get to the destination in a definite or kind of, you know that when you are going to reach the destination. So if we have a bus system which can provide this kind of, and it is possible, quite a bit possible to have this kind of system. So so that could attract more people to use the public buses. So that's the basic idea of this campaign, and we are doing it. We have, of course, Professor Tiwari has talked in the first session, and we have been inviting various people who have been working on different urban issues in Delhi and beyond to talk about it. On behalf of TACC, Naga also joined in the last session that we had, and he talked about why we need to focus also on decreasing the uses of car along with increasing the uses of public buses. And as TACC, I think I'm also the member of this, so we have sort of as TACC endorsed the campaign, and that has been quite encouraging. I guess we will talk about it more, and we need to find out ways in which the campaign and the demands can be made more powerful, and we can realize the demands which are there in the campaign. Thanks.
Yeah, thank you, Nishant. And definitely, as both as a part of the teachers group and also the others who come in, I think we should explore ways how we can sort of carry on the campaign for long and also beyond the question of more buses. Definitely, and thank you very much. And Geetham, thank you so much for such an ambitious presentation and discussion today. And I'm saying this not just from myself, but also just in the chat box, the number of responses I'm seeing of people who found it so enriching. So once again, thank you so much for presenting today.
Thanks. Thank you.
Discussion, and we'll see how one can carry on to sort of engage around these issues and on the question of metro and buses that you sort of highlight today. So thank you very much. Before I end, I just say this to repeat that our next presentation is by Sharad Lele, and that's on 5th October. And it's on climate change and other issues of the environmental crisis. I got the exact title down in the chat box. Anybody interested, please put in your email there in the chat box or send us an email at teachersagainstclimatecrisis@gmail.com. And we'll add you to Google group. It's called Framing Climate Change Within a Broader Environmentalism. That's Sharad Lele from A3 on 5th October at 5:30. So thank you once again, all of you, for joining in, and hope to see you again soon. Bye-bye.
Thanks.